Hi guys, and welcome to another episode of Piano TV, and Happy New Year! Welcome to 2017, and thank you so much for being tolerant of the two-week absence of videos so we could kick back and enjoy the holidays. So anytime there's a new year, I always get to thinking about goals and stuff, as I think a lot of us do, because the new year is the time for goals. So what I thought I'd do with today's video, instead of talking about specific piano goals you can set, I wanted to talk about and brainstorm ways to help you keep your piano practice goals. Because a lot of people make goals at the new year, like, I'm gonna learn how to play piano, or I'm gonna, you know, get my grade 8 in piano or something, but a lot of the times those are just like nice thoughts and ambitions that don't end up being kept. So I wanted to talk today about how to keep those resolutions. So let's get started. So number one, and probably the most important thing when you are setting goals, is you need to make those goals actually specific. They need to be able to be answered in binary terms. So you need to be able to look at a goal and definitively answer yes or no if you've accomplished it. So setting a goal like learn piano, get better at piano, those are very poor goals because they're not specific enough. You can't say very good at piano, yes. There's not really a reference for that. So what we need to say instead is get my level 8 in piano, or learn such and such piece on piano, or do a specific exam on piano, or learn pieces for a recital. Very things that you can say, yes, I've done this. Put a check mark in the box. So number two is a very specific resolution that I myself have given myself to act as, I don't know, an encouraging motivational thing, because I'm not doing any tests. So I wanted something to accomplish, like some type of external thing. So what I'm going to do is put together a seasonal concert type thing. And that makes it sound like really formal, but all I really want to do is learn some like X amount of pieces on a quarterly basis, so say like 6 pieces, and then do a little informal get together with some family or like a few friends or something like that. Just some minor goal that will push me to learn new and exciting music. And number three, you've got to set realistic goals. I mean, if this is your first year of ever playing piano and you're setting a goal of like learn the third movement of Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, you might need to like, you know, check your expectations at the door. This is something that anyone in any field struggles with, is finding that sweet spot between goals that are achievable but a little bit tough so that they stretch you, and finding it so that the goals are not too hard either. So somewhere in between easy and challenging, you want to like pick pieces that are in the middle, and you want to pick goals that are in the middle. And that takes practice, and that comes with time, and we're not always gonna get that right, but it is important to try your absolute best to make sure the goals you're setting aren't going to like be intensely difficult or like way too easy that they don't inspire you. Number four, you need to have a compelling reason to achieve your goals. And this is something we talked about in quite a bit of depth in a video I did back in September called Beyond Goals, I believe it was. So you can check that out. We'll link it below. But in Beyond Goals, we basically talked about like, well, why do you want to practice piano? Why are you learning it? What is like the deeper purpose of it all? So make sure that you're not just like following lists, like, or doing exactly what your teacher says, but you don't like feel connected to what you're learning, because you need to have a connection to what you learn in order to learn it well. So make sure that you have like a greater purpose, and you're not just being like an automaton, kind of just like choosing things off the list because you think you should. Number five is maybe gonna seem like a throwaway to some of you. You might just be like, that's stupid. But this is actually, I think, a lot more important than a lot of us give it credit for. Anyway, I'm just gonna say it. Number five is make sure your practice space is inviting. So if your piano is in like a dungeon basement, or it's really cold, it's not temperature controlled, maybe it's too hot, any of these things, even the decor, making it cozy so it's not just like a piano in a room and like absolutely no ambience. You need to make it an inviting space. It's going to be a place that you want to return to every day. And if you just do a little bit of decoration, or you do what you can to put it in a really nice spot of your house, it's going to go like a long way to making your practice more enjoyable. So I have my piano, well, you can kind of see where I have my piano, but my pianos are in kind of a cold room, so I have some space heaters to warm it up when I'm practicing. And I also have big windows, and I really like having windows in my piano room, because it just gives that, I don't know, it just does something. I've had pianos in windowless rooms before, and it's just not the same. Like, have a plant, have some flowers, put like a nice runner on your piano, or maybe like you have like a bulletin board or you have artwork or anything like that. So number six, I believe in the power of a good practice notebook. I usually switch mine up every year or so because they start to get like really decrepit after a while, but this is the one I picked for the year. It is a really, really nice book. It's black, it's hardcover, and it's got, I don't know, lots of beautiful white blank pages that make me feel inspired. Having a practice journal is just like one of those ways to keep yourself accountable. It's a way to mark down the goals you have, mark down the pieces you've learned, mark down when you started learning something so you can look back and see like, wow, I've been playing this song for 3 months. I gotta like get a move on and start something new, etc., etc. You can use it for anything. I'm pretty sure we've talked about practice journals in a whole separate video, so I'll link to that as well. So number seven, a big part of keeping resolutions is keeping a steady stream of inspiration and motivation. So one of my favorite things to do for that is going to concerts. And all kinds of concerts count. It just depends on what type of music you're learning and what inspires you the most. So I like going to rock concerts and I like going to classical concerts all the same, and they're both inspiring in different ways. I find that rock concerts and like alternative indie, like all those different genre concerts I enjoy, have an energy and a vitality that makes me like super pumped up to play music and to write music. Whereas if I go to a symphony or a piano concert or anything like that, it makes me just like, it just kind of blows my mind with the potential that I could achieve if I practice more. So that keeps me super inspired. So number eight is build an enjoyable routine and ritual around practice. So most of you understand the power of habit. If you have a habit, it's just so much easier to do whatever it is you're trying to do. So if you have the habit of waking up at 6 a.m. and you've got this whole like morning ritual around it, like maybe you wake up and drink coffee and get ready or whatever your ritual is and your routine, it's a lot easier to maintain than if you were to just wake up at 6 a.m. like, I don't know, 3 days a week. Those would be like three really painful days if it's kind of random and maybe the other days you wake up at 8 a.m. or something. Routines are really powerful and they're worth incorporating into your music as well. So if there's some way to, I really like practicing piano in the morning. I have time and freedom in the morning because I work in the evening. So that might not be realistic for everyone, but something about the hours between like 6 and 8 are great for practicing piano. If you could find a way to work even like half an hour into your morning ritual, I find a lot of people have success with that. But you could also build piano practice into like an evening routine, like maybe after supper, you like dim the lights and pull out some good tunes and you have a little like private jam session. All that I'm saying is that if you have a routine or a ritual with piano practice, then you're not gonna have to go through as many layers of resistance, because you know there's that voice in your head that's like, oh, practicing piano is kind of fun, but you know what's more fun? Doing nothing, or like browsing the internet. But if it's just a part of your day, if it's just a habit, it's a lot easier to do. And number nine, you need a path. You need a sense of progression. You need a point A and a point B. What is your point A at the start of this year? And what is the point B that you wanna be at in December of 2017? So I'm never a fan of just like learning random pieces with no structure. I always like there to be like some underlying structure. Like say maybe you wanna complete everything at a level 9, and then by December 2017, you'll be ready for level 10. Or maybe part of your progression is that you want to get through books 1 and 2 of a specific method book in a year. Or maybe you have exams planned or anything like that. Make sure that you have like a very easy to visualize path. And idea number 10 for keeping your piano resolutions is to get a piano teacher. Yes, piano teachers are expensive. Yes, you can learn on your own, all these things that we talk about on this channel. But some people more than others really do well with social accountability, and having weekly piano lessons is a great way to have that social accountability because you have someone who's expecting something of you. It's, for some people, it's a lot easier to break a promise to yourself than to break a promise to someone else. And aside from the social accountability, piano teachers are generally pretty good at structuring your learning so that you can, you know, do what we talked about in 9, have a clear path of learning. Piano teachers can help with that. Number 11 is kind of a general idea that applies to all areas of life aside from just music, but it's really talking about social accountability. It's really important to spend time with people who are going to keep you motivated. So if your goal is to learn how to play piano this year and all your friends just like, I don't know, they come home from work and just like do literally nothing and they have no hobbies, then it's going to be like really hard for you to stand above that and to have hobbies. But if you're hanging around with inspired people who do interesting things, it's going to push you to keep up with them and also be an inspiring person who does inspiring things. I kind of mixed that up, but you get what I'm saying, I hope. Number 12 is spend time every 3 months or so reviewing your goals and adjusting them if you need to. So one of the huge problems with New Year's resolutions that people tend to have is they'll make these amazing resolutions and then they just end up kind of getting forgot about, and yeah, maybe they give you momentum for a month or so and then they just fall by the wayside. So a lot of the times, the goals we set are going to be too challenging or too easy, or maybe we just like changed our mind about something. Maybe we got passionate about something else. Maybe I would set a goal for this year saying I really wanted to learn all of like Beethoven's sonatas. That would be a crazy goal. That's not my goal. But say that was my goal, but then halfway through the year, I just stopped caring about Beethoven and I got really into Debussy. So that would be a point where it might be like time to course correct and change the goal and alter them. So I usually get the urge to start reviewing my goals and restructuring them, reforming them every 3 months or so. So seasonally. So New Year's, like at the start of winter, the start of spring, the start of summer, around fall when school starts again, those are really, really good times to review goals and make sure you're still on course, and if you're not, to correct that course. Number 13, put your goals where you can see them. So again, the same problem with we were talking about in number 12 is a lot of times people will set New Year's resolutions and then it falls out of their mind and they didn't write it down anywhere, so it just kind of gets lost in space and time, never to return. So you want to put your goals in a place where you kind of have to be confronted with them on a regular basis, if not daily, maybe at least like every couple days. So I like to put my goals at the front of my new notebook. I got my goals at the front of here. Or you could find a digital way to do it. So you could put your goals on your desktop wallpaper, like your computer laptop wallpaper or something. Or you could have your goals written up in a word processing document that you could save to the front screen of your phone as like a little clickable file. Anything like that, like anything that forces you to, hey, yeah, I remember that goal, is something that you want to incorporate. Number 14, another social accountability one, is to play in a group or a band. So if you're a solo piano player, you can play at church, you could play in like a rock band as the keyboardist, you could do like duos with a violin player. There are a ton of options, and even if you live in a really small town like I do, there's almost always opportunities to play music with people, and it doesn't have to be anything fancy. Like, you don't have to play with these people and do like world tours or anything. You can just like literally get together on Saturday nights with some friends and jam. And it's amazing how big of a difference. That's a really, really big one for me. I find when my band's jamming regularly, I'm pretty diligent, and when our jamming falls by the wayside, so does my practice. So that's something to consider. And finally, number 15 is to build your self-discipline muscle. So at the start of the new year, a lot of us are usually like really motivated and we have a lot of energy, and that energy carries us through a few weeks, even a few months, depending. But there's always going to be a point where we lose steam. There's always going to be a point where we don't want to practice. I mean, yes, music is supposed to be fun, and you should have fun doing it most of the time. But you're not always going to just be like, oh yeah, I can't wait to go practice piano. There are going to be days where you're really tired. Or, I don't know, maybe you had like a really hard day, maybe like bad day at work, things like that. That can happen. And that can happen not just like on a, like every once in a while. You can have like maybe a bad month or a bad 2 months. Michael's sneezing over there. Bless you! So in these times where our motivation is low, it doesn't mean we shouldn't practice, because that's poor decision making. So in these moments where our motivation is low, we need to be able to fall back on our self-discipline to keep us practicing, even when we don't necessarily have like this burning drive to do so, because consistency is so important. So one important thing to remember is that some practice is better than no practice. So if you normally practice like an hour and a half, good on you, but there will be days where you just can't fathom practicing for that long. And even getting to the piano for 10 minutes is better than not going at all because your practice time seems too daunting. So one thing that I like to do when practicing piano seems like too much of a challenge is I'll think of it like, okay, well, I'll go practice for 5 minutes because 5 minutes is easy. Anyone can do 5 minutes. It doesn't matter how busy you are. And if I really, really, really struggled with those 5 minutes and I really don't want to keep going, then I don't have to. I did 5 minutes. I did my time. But what happens most of the time is once you get to the piano, you play for 5 minutes, you're like, oh, okay, this is fun. I could keep doing this. So something to try. And that is all for today's video. Let me know if you have any other ideas or anything that helps you stick to your New Year's resolutions. I'd love to hear it in the comments. And I just wanted to say thank you everyone who helped out on Patreon. So we did hit our goal of $100, which means I owe you guys a video of Tsunami getting fed the cat treat. So I'm gonna be working on that right away. And hopefully she's not like really boring about it. Hopefully it's like at least kind of funny. We'll see what happens. Thank you to everyone who contributed on Patreon and just like all of you for watching and giving these video likes and support. It's awesome and it helps us keep this train rolling. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you to our sponsor over here on the right. And I will catch you guys in the next video. Will any of you judge me if I use my jacket as a blanket? It's so cold in here.